Okay, we're going to get going. First of all, good afternoon. I'm Darrell West, Vice President of Governance Studies and Director of the Center for Technology Innovation here at the Brookings Institution. And I'd like to welcome you to our forum on mobile technology's impact on political campaigns, both in the United States as well as around the world. We are webcasting this event, so we're pleased to welcome viewers from various states as well as countries. We've set up a Twitter hashtag at TechCTI. That's TechCTI. So those of you who'd like to offer comments and/or pose questions are welcome to do so. And when we come to the audience Q&A, we will take questions both from our live as well as our virtual audiences. And today is Valentine's Day, so happy Valentine's Day. We appreciate you spending some of your day with us here. I'm wearing a little bit of red in honor of that occasion. In terms of our subject for today, mobile technology is playing an increasing role in political campaigns. Voters are using smartphones and mobile devices to learn about the campaign, to watch videos, and to text friends. We all remember in 2008 that candidate Obama announced his vice presidential choice via a text message to 2.9 million people. Since then, we have seen a proliferation of mobile ads, video links, and apps of various sorts. For example, people in the 2010 elections who attended the Minnesota State Fair received targeted ads on their mobile devices from Michelle Bachmann's congressional campaign, informing them that her opponent supported a tax increase on food. The message went as follows, quote, "I know it's state fair time and you don't want to hear about politics, but while you're at the fair, you should know that Terrell Clark voted to raise taxes on your corn dog and your deep fried bacon and your beer." Now, those of you from Minnesota know those are fighting words, especially the deep fried bacon and the beer. But this is a harbinger of what we're going to see. The geolocation features, along with mobile technology, are enabling candidates to target ads geographically at specific events. So we'll be seeing a lot more of that in this political campaign. We're seeing innovative outreach in other countries as well. For example, the Berlin Green Party has a mobile app that brings party billboards to life. People can point their phone at a billboard and an app will launch that brings a mobile video message to their phone that discusses environmental issues in greater depth and refers them to a website where they can get additional information. We can see that mobile technology is transforming field organization and public outreach. For example, the Obama campaign this year is allowing volunteers to log onto the Obama website with their Facebook account and access any tool that you typically would get in a campaign field office. So people can make calls, they can identify supporters, and then they enter that information into a comprehensive database. This gives the campaign real-time data on how people are responding. And so it provides interesting strategic advantages for the campaign. Romney, and I'm sure other candidates are following similar strategies. Romney's digital director, Zach Moffitt, for example, is having people watch video online, engage with the campaign, share the video at their personal networks, and try and convince their friends to support the candidate. The only part of mobile campaigning that is lagging in the United States is political fundraising via text messaging. In 2010, the FEC ruled that voters cannot text $10 contributions to candidates for federal office. The FEC was concerned about disclosure rules and fear that either foreigners or corporations would direct gifts to politicians. Now, in my view, I think this FEC ruling is short-sighted because it discourages small donors in political races. We need ways in American politics to empower small donors to offset the rising power of large donors in national campaigns. We've all seen the super ads, the super PACs, the negative ads that they have run funded basically by large contributors. There are two states that already have authorized text donations to candidates for statewide offices. That's California and Maryland. Abroad, we see countries such as the United Kingdom and South Africa that are doing the same thing. And in my view, it's time for the FEC to kind of get with it and allow people to text small donations to candidates for a federal office. Today, we're putting out a paper entitled M-Campaigning, Mobile Technology and Public Outreach. If you didn't already get a copy, you can pick up one on your way out, or the paper also is at our website at brookings.edu. And the paper shows the range of public outreach tools that are being used by various candidates, political parties, activists, and reporters, and shows how this is strengthening citizen engagement with our political process. This paper is part of a three-year mobile economy project. Roughly every 3 months, we're going to be doing a forum and putting out a paper on different aspects of mobile technology. And we're very grateful for the generous financial support provided by Qualcomm for this project. It will enable us to undertake research and hold public forums on various aspects of the mobile economy. Today, we're pleased to welcome a number of distinguished guests to help us understand M-campaigning. All these individuals have been on the front lines and are addressing different aspects of this topic. Scott Goldstein is founder and CEO of Revolution Messaging. It's a company specializing in cutting-edge communication strategies for the mobile world. Previously, he was the external online director for Obama for America, where he helped develop the campaign's social networking platforms. He helped build the campaign's lifestyle marketing strategy and its mobile strategy, including text messaging, downloads, interactive voice responses, and its mobile website. Katie Harbeth is associate manager of policy for Facebook. She works with candidates and elected officials on the best ways to use Facebook for public outreach. Previously, she worked as chief digital strategist for the National Republican Senatorial Committee. She also served as deputy e-campaign director for Rudy Giuliani's presidential campaign in 2008, where she was responsible for his electronic outreach. Aaron Smith is senior research specialist at the Pew Research Center's Internet and American Life Project. His areas of expertise include the role of the internet in the political process, technology and civic life, and online engagement with government. He's also authored research on mobile internet usage and demographic trends in technology adoption. He is a guy with the survey numbers that you read about all the time in terms of people, in terms of how people are actually using mobile technology. Daniel Urena is managing director at MAS Consulting, a public affairs firm that provides strategic support to senior management and institutional clients in Spain, Mexico, Argentina, Colombia, Brazil, and Venezuela, as well as elsewhere. He's also a professor in the Department of Political Science at the University of Pontificia Comillas, where he directs the graduate program of public affairs and management of election campaigns. Since last year, he's been the coordinator of the Public Leadership Classroom, an initiative of the university that promotes dialogue and collaboration between business, politics, and civil society. He is the first Spanish consultant to receive the Rising Star Award from Campaigns and Elections magazine, and he has been awarded several Poly Awards by the American Association of Political Consultants. Our last speaker will be Clark Gibson, who's professor and chairman of the Department of Political Science at the University of California at San Diego. He studies the politics of development, democracy, and the environment in Africa, Central America, and South America. His current research focuses on the accountability between governments and citizens in Africa. He's the founder of the Project on African Political Economy, which looks at political accountability, the determinants of voting, and the provision of public services in Africa's emerging democracy. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to, in terms of our format, pose a question to each of our speakers. We'll have a little bit of time for a conversation among ourselves, and then we will open the floor to questions and comments, both from the live audience as well as people who are watching the webcast. So to kick off our conversation, I'm going to start with Scott. And you've thought a lot about how mobile technology and digital technology have evolved from 2008, and it's used both for positive as well as negative purposes. So could you summarize what you view as the evolution of this technology?
Actually get people involved in and actually get more people out to vote. It was a very simple program. We had our own unique short code that spelled the candidate's name Obama. Text join to 62262. You all saw it at different rallies and events. And it was exciting. But now I think mobile has grown up and advanced, and people are demanding more from a text message program. They want breaking news on their phones. They're going to get upset if they join your mobile program and there's not breaking alerts of what's happening. And so I think it's advanced from sort of the novelty of text messaging being used for what I'd like to say is good, getting more people involved in civic education. We were the first program to actually think about how do we make sure we have two-way text messaging. So a young person who on average texts somewhere around 2,000 to 3,000 text messages a month. Pew can give better statistics than I can on this. But how do they actually feel real interaction with the campaign? To now what we're seeing is actually similar to, if you all remember, the original Bill Clinton robocalls. Like my grandmother actually thought like Bill Clinton was calling her and encouraging her to get out and vote, right? That was like the first cycle in the mid-90s. But by the end of the 90s, everybody hated these nefarious autocalls that would happen in the middle of the night. Telling you the wrong information of where to go and vote or fake information from a campaign. And so I see this is sort of a new form of technology that was used in 2007 and 2008 around real excitement, getting people involved and engaged in a campaign, getting real information on their phones for the first time, to 2010, 2011 being used for nefarious reasons, people getting millions of text messages by district of illegal text message spam that just goes to their phone and gives them a negative opinion of politics and being ruined for the discourse. Plus, according to the FCC and everybody else, is that you're now also having to pay for this messaging to get onto your phone of negative campaigning. So I would encourage everybody, my firm has actually taken this up with the FCC. We've got a petition going on with Julius Janikowski over there to put an end to this. It's pocketspamming.com. And it's a way to sort of get people to know that these issues are happening. So as new technologies come out, they can be used for good, but also they're being used very stealthily and very quickly for evil, and we want to put an end to that and close all the loopholes. So feel free to either visit our website or visit pocketspammers.com.
Okay, and those of you who are standing in the back, we do have some remaining seats in the front row, so feel free to take those seats. They do say reserve, but they're reserved for you, so don't be inhibited by that. Katie, you joined Facebook, you worked for the Republican Senatorial Campaign Committee, so you have some experience in terms of what works and what doesn't work. So can you give us the benefit of your experience and especially how the social part of campaigning is being changed?
Absolutely. I think that a big part, while text messaging is a huge part of your mobile program, I think it it always drives me nuts that people think text messaging is the only mobile part of your of what you should be paying attention to. Having a mobile website and having realizing that people are reading your emails mostly on mobile, many times on mobile devices. And so looking at one thing that I try to do at the Senatorial Committee is, especially on the Republican side, we didn't really have a baseline of how our folks were really engaging with us on mobile. So what I first started to do is I took a look at our Google Analytics, where you can do an advanced segment just by mobile users. And I was shocked at how much traffic we were actually getting from mobile. And so we started to put efforts into building up a mobile website. We created an iPhone application and started to test different mobile ads. And what we found was, especially our mobile ads on Election Day, we had it for people to be able to find their polling place, was that more people were actually using our mobile ads and they were actually cheaper because not as many people were bidding on them. Because when people are out and about wondering where to vote, they're probably searching on it on their phone. They're not searching for it necessarily on a computer. And so my big recommendations, and another thing we found too, was that with our iPhone app, doing Alert notifications worked very well in addition to a text messaging program that we might have. Especially with election results, as it got later in the night, I didn't necessarily want to wake people up with a text message at midnight sharing who. Scott's getting over here. He's going to start clocking me.
We woke him up at 3 a.m. Come on.
But it's something to think about, because with notifications, you can also reach a segment of folks who maybe have downloaded your app but aren't necessarily on your text messaging program. But the big thing that I learned is that even if you think you don't have a mobile campaign happening right now, you do. Because there are people visiting your website, there are people who are reading your emails on mobile devices, and if you're not looking to see what your website and what your content looks like on those, you're really doing a disservice to your users and probably losing folks. And then in terms of social, what we've been seeing a lot more of, and I really like what the Republican National Committee does with their text messaging program, in that they share videos over text message, but then there's a link in that text message to share it on Facebook. Or they encourage people to share it on Twitter. And so more and more, Nielsen has found that it's actually people 50 plus that are driving social media use on phones. Because I use my parents as an example, it's easier for them to use an iPad, an iPhone, or an Android device than it is necessarily a computer. So that's how they're checking their Facebook account to keep up with me and my brothers and sisters. And so be thinking about those users as you are going through your campaigns, and just take a look at your stats, because we went from, at the NRSC, from having 3% of our traffic being mobile in July to it being 10% in November. And some of that's just election traffic, but a lot of it is mobile use is skyrocketing. And so if you're not paying attention to it, you're really losing a big chunk of people that want to interact with you.
It's funny, you mentioned the problem of text messaging at midnight. I remember there was a congressional candidate who was using robocalls, but inadvertently programmed the phones to start ringing at 3 a.m. as opposed to 3 p.m. I don't think that candidate did so well. But. Aaron, you have done surveys at Pew on cell phones and mobile devices. What are the broader trends that you're seeing in terms of how citizens are using these new devices?
Sure, and so I think Scott actually hit it on the head when he said that mobile has grown up over the last several years. And one of the things that, you know, for someone like me who's been studying this for the last few years, you know, we've seen that, you know, the idea of constant connectivity combined with ubiquitous access to your social network has really become a mainstream activity within the broader population. So half the population, or the adult population, is now on social networking sites. When you look at smartphone adoption, it's gone from about 35% in May or so of last year to, in our more recent surveys that we've done in the last few weeks, it's close to 50%. And Nielsen has found largely the same things. And more, I think, importantly than that is that it's moved from the sort of kind of 20-something urbanite population and is starting to diffuse within groups that were not as did not have as high levels of adoption as in the past. So in 2008 to 2010, in terms of political activity, what we saw with Facebook and social networking sites was a move from the sort of young, kind of Democratic-leaning Obama supporters who really dominated the scene in 2008 to older, sometimes more conservative, Tea Party-leaning folks who really became much more active in the 2010 process. And so it'll be interesting for us to see, you know, if we see a similar sort of shift in the mobile political landscape from, you know, the sort of young urbanites who were active doing this in 2010 to, you know, kind of a more broader, more representative segment of the population in 2012. So generally speaking, that's sort of what we're looking to measure, is how that broader diffusion is going to be impacting the way that people interact with the political process. And so some of the things, in addition to that sort of broader diffusion that we're looking at as we start to think about our political surveys this year, is sort of the impact of this just-in-time information that mobile offers to people. And so, you know, Katie mentioned, you know, hitting people when they're out and about. And we've seen that in a lot of our work around, you know, people making last-minute purchasing decisions by relying on their phones to tell them whether they're getting a good deal or whether they're getting something that is going to work for them. I fully expect to see that same type of behavior in the political process, with people relying on their friends, relying on the internet at large to tell them, you know, who they should be voting for, what they should feel about a particular issue, you know, what the heck is this ballot initiative that I haven't heard of you know, until I'm walking up to my polling place and I see a sign and can sort of learn more about it. So that's one of the things that we'll be looking at. The other, sort of in a general sense, is the kind of impulse-driven nature of a lot of this engagement. We've done some work recently around text donors, around people who contributed to the Text to Haiti campaign. And one of the things we found is that that type of donation is much more sort of ephemeral or impulse-driven than some of the traditional forms of giving that we've seen in our previous research. So people aren't necessarily you know, thinking long and hard about a particular issue or following something for a long time before they make a decision. They're seeing something right there that grabs them, and they can immediately make some sort of action that, that takes them to a new stage in the process. And so I think it'll be really interesting to track how people are using their mobile phones to facilitate that type of engagement throughout the political process this year. So looking forward to the Q&A, and I'll pass it on.
Okay, thank you. Daniel, you work on campaigns in Europe as well as elsewhere, so I was wondering if you could give us a European perspective on how you see mobile technology being used in the election campaigns that you've been involved with.
Okay, well, thank you, first of all, for inviting me and giving me the opportunity to share some thoughts with all of you. Well, every single day I see that the main problem for many politicians, not only in Europe, also in Latin America, I don't know, maybe in America, is the growing distance between politicians and people. For example, in my country, the last polls that have been published, when you ask which are the three main problems that we have in Spain, the answer is unemployment, economy, and politics. So that's an interesting fact. So
it's unusual from the standpoint of the United States. So,
I think politics should be part of the solution. It should not be a part of the problem. So I think something is not working. In my opinion, this sad reality, I think it has to do with the lack of understanding by politicians of how fast is the world changing. We were talking some minutes before that we can do some predictions that maybe in the next conference they will not work because technology is changing the world so fast. No, so my point is, in Europe, in Latin America, where my firm is working very actively, I think that while politicians are discussing, while they are attacking each other, people is changing their social habits. They are changing the way they communicate. They are changing the way they access to information. They are changing how they share their thoughts and opinions and how they organize themselves. So I think many politicians are forgetting this part of the picture.
Okay. Clark, you've written about how cell phones have helped to reduce electoral fraud in Uganda and Afghanistan. Can you tell us about your research and what you have found?
Sure. Thanks again, Daryl, for inviting us. So together with Qualcomm, our team at UCSD reduced electoral fraud in Afghanistan and Uganda by between 25 and 60%, which is astonishing. Only when you understand how simple this whole project is. So it's clear that I'm not talking about campaigns, but kind of a more general promotion of democracy. And to improve elections is to improve democracy, you would think. And democracy, as many, many studies have shown, is involved with improving human rights, economic outcomes. So the idea is to improve these elections. How do we do it? The standard form of election monitoring that we've used in our country, in many countries, Europe, is to send election observers. That's pretty standard. And they do a great job in establishing public support for an election. The difficulty is actually knowing what they do on the ground to fraud. So we wanted to come up with a more rigorous way to try to detect and actually suppress fraud, trying to use both really rigorous science and mobile technology. So excuse the professor and me. I'll quickly describe it if I can. But go back to your
bio. But this will be in less than an hour.
No, yeah. Is that all?
I can say that as a former professor.
Exactly. Myself. It's hard to get professors to talk about their research. So if you go back to your biology class, we're really basing it on classic science, which is a control and a treated group. And when you compare the control to your intervention, did your, for example, a drug trial, did the drug have any effect? Very simple. A little harder to pull off in the field, but not impossible. So what we did in Afghanistan and in Uganda is a random sample of polling stations. That's what you want for a controlled trial. Half the sample gets a letter, simply a letter, from a research firm that's a local research firm. And the letter says, we're going to take a picture of the tallies that you must post at the end of the day. It doesn't say we're going to throw you in jail. It doesn't say we're from the US or from the EU. It merely says we're going to take a picture. At the end of the day, the places that got the letter and the places that didn't, in both places, we send researchers with smartphones. Qualcomm designed this really nice app for us for this purpose. They take a picture of the vote. They answer a few questions. They hit send, and it goes to my server in my office immediately. So we have the actual record, the picture of the polling station tally. We compare the tallies, and it's pretty easy. It's something called digit analysis, and I'll go quickly through that. As a human being, you can't generate random numbers. We're just poor animals. We don't have that mental capability to generate random numbers. But you can detect non-random numbers in results. And the idea is contiguous digits. Humans, after a while, if you're filling in forms illegally, will use 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, 4, 5, 6, more than random. More than random. So if you look at the results and you see more than a random assignation of contiguous digits, it's pretty easy to determine that there was some fudging going on. You compare the rate of contiguous digits in the treated and untreated, and you find this dramatic effect on the reduction of fraud. It's a terrific way, it's one tool, but a really precise, scientifically valid way with really enormous impacts. Now, the vision in the future, again, with Qualcomm and others, is to make it a cloud-based software. Let's let citizen groups download it on their Android platforms, and then they would have another tool to hold their governments accountable. Slightly more rigorous, a little more scientific than right now, where people take pictures of fraud and report fraud. This is a step up and a way to detect unfair elections. And everyone in all of these countries casting a ballot believes they should be able to change things. And here's another tool. We're very excited about it.
Okay, I'd like to throw out a couple of questions, and any of you who want to jump in can do so. Is mobile technology just a new toy, or is it something that's actually going to transform how we run political campaigns? And is it going to actually improve the process, or is it just going to introduce some new pathologies? I mean, Scott already mentioned the concept of pocket spamming as a potential pathology. We can see how our news cycle is getting speeded up. Could that be a problem? How do you think this is going to play out and affect the system as a whole? Anyone who wants to jump in?
I'll jump in on particularly the news side. I think that, first of all, I don't think that this is sort of a flash in the pan. I think this is a part of the fundamental transformation of really technology and going to the next level and just more and more people carrying around devices like this all the time and getting a lot of information off of them. Where I still want to see and I haven't yet is in terms of that 24-hour news cycle. If you think in terms of campaigns, you know, they're on the bus throughout the day. If there's a commercial that comes out, right, what it used to be is you'd have to stop the bus, get the reporter pool together, let them get their cameras set up so that you could respond. Now immediately the candidate, the campaign communications director can send a tweet, can post to Facebook, can take a quick video of the candidate responding to it and put it out, and be able to very quickly respond rapidly in a way that when the war room was first set up in 1992 by Clinton's folks, like, was never, you know, even imagined. So I think that, you know, people might lament the sort of very fast news cycle we have, but it's really giving campaigns that ability to talk directly to voters and to counter one another that doesn't necessarily require them to go through the press. But then you also have the press, who you're getting an unprecedented behind-the-scenes view of how these campaigns work, by the pictures they're taking on Twitter, the videos that they're sharing on Facebook, whatever it might be. I personally really enjoy it, but I'm also a very big political junkie. But I think, too, in terms of interacting with people, the most important thing is that you can't be forcing your mobile strategy into what you want it to be, into what they're already doing online. You're going to have a much more successful one if you're sort of listening and looking at what people care about and engaging with them and not just trying to talk at them using this technology. And it doesn't matter if it's mobile or computer. But the campaigns that do that right will have really good success. And just one quick example, Scott Brown campaign last January. When Martha Coakley would be on the radio station, a text message would go out to their list saying, here's the phone number to call in, ask her about her taxes, or something like that. It was a great way to immediately mobilize supporters, and all of a sudden she would be flooded with questions that she didn't want on that radio show.
That's the reason we're careful on our webcast in terms of taking questions. Scott?
I think I should add to that, and I think that what Katie's saying is 100%. Accurate. But these tools all still have their own specific needs for a campaign. So in the U.S., text messaging is an amazing and the only tool that really pushes your base to take active action. Twitter and Facebook, you actually have to log in and sort of passive in the background, where text messaging still pops and stops every single thing on your phone. So if you have a very active text message list that you spend a lot of time to build, again, it's going to be your base voters. It's not going to replace persuasion, because how many people are going to sign up to your text message list to get persuaded, right, at whatever the cost of your text message list is? But that being said, the example in Wisconsin during this year's public employee battles, to send a text message out to the base and say, look, the Republicans just passed legislation without a single Democrat in the room. Show up at the Capitol right now and again tomorrow morning at 9 a.m., we then watch people take that text message, copy it from their phone, drop it to their Twitter, drop it to their Facebook, send it to an email, and show up at the Capitol. So I do think, and I can't agree more with Katie on the fact that these tools are here to stay. The campaigns didn't even have to do that, right? It could have been somebody else sending out that text message. It happened to be that the campaign was sophisticated and organized. In the Scott Brown case as well, it was a campaign that was sophisticated and organized. But if you can tap into the culture of what everyone else is already doing, we're already seeing millions and millions of Americans text messaging, whether we like it or not, while they're driving, on the bus, watching TV, making dinner, whatever it is, right? We're addicted to this tool, and so now we're actually adding political organizing to this all in one sense. The one thing I will also like to add is that it's fascinating to have a panel where we actually have a global perspective. The problem in the U.S. is that the carriers are really still the hindrance to a lot of this. If you think about it, text messaging still is not approved as First Amendment freedom of speech. You have to still get a short code. It's expensive to set up. There's a right way to do these things. And, you know, the FEC concept of donations and some other things, there's still some quirkiness. We're still in our infancy of getting these technologies to really start humming with the campaign.
Okay, Clark, is this just a new toy?
Oh, gosh. For the rest of the world, those of you who might be interested in the rest of the world, political junkies outside the U.S., I was in Tahrir Square in November during their parliamentary elections, and on the square there were T-shirts being sold. The new tools of revolution.
Yeah.
And the pictures were, or the logos were probably illegal, Twitter, Facebook, Google, so they're selling those shirts. So that's an obvious example of how mobile technology is changing everything overseas. All the crowds in Russia, all the crowds in Egypt. These are all being driven by text messages and cell phones. This is why these governments want to shut them down. The Taliban shuts down lots of Afghanistan, the towers, when it hopes to. Uganda did. So there's this relationship between its power as a social movement tool that will never go away unless, again, the big switch is pulled by the central government. But these are the tools of political accountability. Never will go away.
Daniel, what do you think the system impact will be?
Yeah, my impression is that technology, mobile technology, is not something cool. It's not something in fashion. I think it's a huge innovation. I think after television, after internet, I think it's the next social revolution. But in this scenario, I think we don't have to forget what is the essence of politics, people. I think the essence of politics is people working for people. The essence of campaigns is people trying to persuade people, people communicating with people. And I think I would like to bring to two ideas to the table, that technology is a mean, is a great tool for political engagement, it's a huge opportunity. But I think that personal contact, the personal contact with a citizen, with a politician, will be always the most powerful tool. So we don't have to do mobile campaigns. It's only a part of the campaign, because when we have a new innovation, we think that everything will change, but I think the essence will be always the personal contact with people.
Aaron, what do you think the long-term impact will be?
So we've actually asked people about this, and when you ask people what they think the impact of this stuff is, you get a very classic response, which is that it's great for me, but I don't know about the rest of all you people. So you see that a lot in polling that we do. So people think the education system's going down the tubes, but they love the teacher at their kid's school. They think the healthcare system is the pits, but they love their primary care physician. And so when we ask them about the impact of technology on the way they interact with the political process, they say, it's great for me. I can feel more connected with the issues that I'm interested in. I can find other people who share my views about those issues and interact with them in a meaningful way that I couldn't do before this stuff came along. At the same time, when you ask them sort of about the broader impacts, they start to say, oh, well, yeah, it does kind of, I'm worried that other people might, get more susceptible to extreme viewpoints, or that the loudest voices can dominate the discussion. So, whether that ultimately portends, sort of a good or bad thing for society is for probably someone smarter than me to decide. But you see a very classic response, in that they see very clear advantages to them personally in the way that they can interact with the things that interest them, but do see some concerns around some of the broader impacts that, kind of other people who are, maybe less capable than they themselves of handling experience when they sort of bring this out to a broader level.
Let's move to the audience to give you a chance to ask some questions. We have Sarah Wheaton, who is here. She's the New York Times editor for the paper's 2012 mobile app. And I've asked her just to add a little bit in terms of a reporter's perspective and how the mobile app affects the way in which she does her job. There's a microphone coming up. She's right here.
Hi. Thanks, Darrell. So as the strategists are discussing, the campaigns are trying to give people instant information, and the media are trying to keep up. And so at the Times, we have started a new app called Election 2012, and it's free. It is an aggregated app, so even though we think, of course, the Times brings you the best political coverage, we recognize that that campaign coverage is very collaborative. And so a dedicated editor, I not at the moment, obviously, but
a little self-promotional there.
Yes, just moving on from that, but I'm devoted all day, every day, to bringing people the best coverage from all over the web. So for example, there's a new section in the app about Mitt Romney's op-ed today in the Detroit News, reaffirming his opposition to the auto bailout. And so we have our coverage of the op-ed, we have his Detroit News op-ed, we have a link to his 2008 op-ed in the Times, and we also have a tweet from Nate Silver about how this position might play in Michigan. We also have live election results on election nights and cool maps where people can kind of zero in on electoral data from around the country. And we recognize that political junkies need to have information in a manageable way available to them all the time that keeps up with the speed of the campaign. So that's what we're doing in the MSM.
Thank you very much. So any of you who are watching on the webcast who would like to ask a question, you can post the question at our Twitter feed, #TechCTI, #TechCTI. Questions from our live audience here. And don't everyone speak at once, because that is so rude.
And Pew says you're only going to use like 5 apps, so you should probably use her app as one of the 5 from his recent report.
Okay, Stephanie has a question from our Twitter feed.
Hi, we have a question from Nansen Mullen in CV, Washington, and she directs this specifically at Katie.
Oh, man.
Oh. How is, oh. She says,
probably
how,
coming from a Democrat, by the way.
No, I know Nansen.
She's asking how mobile technology is nationalizing local elections, and how helpful is that?
That's a really great question. One of the things that I like to say, so Tip O'Neill always likes to say all politics is local, but online it's really very national. Especially you saw it last cycle in 2010 with so many of these races. What we were seeing was, you know, the campaigns would try to only do advertising or any other focus just in their state, and they were really missing out on a lot of people nationally who wanted to share, who wanted to donate to their campaign or share content. And one of the things that, you know, I think where social media can really come in handy and really making a social experience for people, whether it's on mobile or your website, is people move around a lot more. They've got friends all over the country. Imagine if you could log in with Facebook and have people see their friends who live in that state and who can vote. And so if I'm from Wisconsin. If I wanted to log in and ask my friends in Wisconsin to go vote, you know, if somebody gave me that app, that's a very easy way for me to do that and to easily hit all of my friends in Wisconsin. So I think that there's a very good way to take, you know, a national, your local campaign, make it national and turn it back local again and keep that viral aspect going.
In addition to that, the one cool feature that still stays at the time of the original Obama mobile app that we did on iPhone was literally spinning your address book by geo-targeted state. Mm-hmm. So you could actually push that in. And so you had to then have a coordination between the field offices and the field strategy and the digital offices, and they had to actually get along, which hasn't really happened since, I would say, 2008 in that sort of sophistication way. It's going to be exciting to see how more and more people can do exactly what Katie's talking about, nationalize an issue that they truly care about that's happening in a ballot initiative that's happening in maybe 5 states, and really start pushing that through very sophisticated mobile apps, geolocation, and even mobile video that wasn't available in 2008. I don't know how many of you remember in 2008, you couldn't think about, like, well, what was your data plan of your phone, and you didn't really have a smart enough phone, right? The iPhone was barely out for less than a year, and now we've changed the market completely with the advent of Google's operating system, with the Android phones now being available for less than $40. So all the stuff that Kay's talking about nationalizing stuff and then now linking it with mobile to move it even more rapidly.
Okay, other questions? Right here, we have a question. If we can get a microphone. Yeah, if we could ask you to give your name and your organization as well.
Okay, hi, my name is Truls Wickholm. I'm from Norway. I'm a member of parliament in Norway from Social Democratic Party. And my question is, you were talking about text messages just being the things that now pop up and the sure way to reach your voters. How do you think that iMessage and the new Messenger app from Facebook is going to change that? Because those two apps have the same capability and people are starting to use them more and more because it's free.
Yeah, and if there's anybody here from Apple that wants to give us APIs to get into that iMessage gateway, I would really appreciate that. It's going to happen. BlackBerry messaging, iMessage are going to start changing, and the U.S. carrier systems know that they have to step up. Right now, though, if you're a campaign and you need to broadcast to everybody, text messaging has not really been sexy in the United States in a long time, but for political activism, it is the one way to get across everybody's phones. iMessaging, you may be able to segment your list into who's on iPhone and then send them an iMessage notification to save them a little bit of money. But ultimately, you want something on your phone that's going to push and demand that they do something. What the channel is and how you segment your list, it really isn't about the technology to me. It's more about how do I actually get something to actively pop on the phone. So you're 100% correct. It's just for national broadcasting at this point, iMessaging is just not there yet. Soon.
Okay, over here next to the wall is a question. We have the microphone coming over to you right there.
Thanks. Benjamin Williamson from London, currently between jobs and organizations. There's the old adage that decisions are made by people who show up. Do you think now decisions are made by people who are online? And if so, is there not a slight danger that we're moving towards a system where it's becoming a bit more of a polarization? Those people who are already disenfranchised, those people who are already inactive, would become more so. And is there anything that we can do in rolling out mobile technology to those people?
One thing that you might want to look at, so if you go to facebook.com/Facebook data, some of our guys actually did a study starting to look at how people get information and who they get it from. And while they do pay attention a lot to their very close core group of friends, because people have a lot of friends as well on Facebook or social networks that they're not necessarily close to but also have differing opinions, they actually found that, you know, if they are, people are getting differing opinions and it's not necessarily an echo chamber. So you might want to go look at that and kind of look at that study. It's a really great one to look at. And then my only other point would be I still think that the adage remains that it's people who show up, and online it's people who show up online. There's a lot of people who are online who maybe aren't even paying attention to the political process. Online just gives them a much easier way in which to participate that doesn't require them. Look at phone banking. You can now phone bank from home and never even have to go down to sign up for a two-hour shift, have to find the location, get down there and do it. If you have 5-10 minutes from home, you can do that. And then as people start to integrate social into it, you can Gingrich had this for a while. You could log into the phone bank application, see your friends who are making phone calls. And now all of a sudden it's become a shared experience with your friends, even though you didn't have to be in the exact same place at the exact same time. And so I think we'll start seeing a lot more of that as well.
Clark, is this technology just going to reinforce existing social and economic inequities?
It's a great question. And in general, I would say no. Because ruling parties in fragile democracies depend on ignorance, especially in the rural areas. And that's where parties usually cling to for a long time. Movements often come from urban areas. Now, the urban areas, yes, they're enfranchised by mobile technology because they can afford it. But all the things that our panelists are saying are going to hit all of these countries. So 10 years ago, polling started in these countries. Ruling parties do want to know how they're doing. Now there's some polling by phone, by cell phone, in fact. In Egypt, they have the CADI system, which is the automatic calling systems to landlines and cell phones. All these places will get this technology. But, you know, in general, you want a more informed public. In some ways, because showing up is dangerous in these places. Right? If you're in this square, it's a little more dangerous than if you get something on mobile technology. So this actually may be a nice stepping stone to showing up.
Okay, other questions? In the very back, there's a question.
So I work on voter engagement in communities of color, Latinos, African Americans, and I thought that between 2008 and 2012, we'd make tremendous jumps given how many cell phones exist in those communities and that it was such a promising infrastructure for engaging people who haven't been engaged. So I actually think the opposite of, you know, the idea that you could disenfranchise people more by not having the right technology. Mobile is the place where we could actually find people in ways that we've never been able to before.
We see the exact same thing in our work as well, so.
Yeah, and I'm basing this on Pew numbers.
This is all from you, Aaron.
So given those statistics, I'm actually really interested in why we haven't made more progress in the last 4 years in building out that infrastructure and why the number, I mean, there are no people of color on this panel. There is still very little work happening that I think is revolutionizing the way that we could be accessing these communities using mobile tech, and I'm interested in what's sort of in the way.
Responses?
I guess mine, and Scott might have an idea too. I think, you know, it's still also very, while we have made great strides, it also still is very new. And also especially from my angle, the political strategist side, there's still very few folks who kind of do this and working on campaigns. And I hope to see more and more people like you becoming very, you know, experts in this and doing mobile and, you know, start publishing results, have a blog, use Facebook, use Twitter to start to do that and help to build up that expertise and do that. But I'm really excited to see, even where this keeps going further as more and more people start testing it out in different communities.
Yeah, the only thing I would add to that is Nokia's Lumi that's coming out at like $27 a smartphone. You've got Samsung that's coming out with $25 to $30 smartphones. Droids on Cricket and Metro PCS that are $40 smartphones. So you're going to put this type of iPhone tool in the hands of a lot more people. But the gateway of getting into an iPhone app and having to do smart development and all this stuff is gone now. So for the first time, you can use mobile web with universal coding experience very easily. So you no longer have to have an app that's approved through iTunes, et cetera, et cetera. I think that we're lowering the barriers. The other thing is that the Obama campaign really wanted us, David Plouffe challenged us every day, that he wanted a kid at the door to be able to go, oh, you want to know Barack Obama's position on the war? Here, let me show you a little video on my phone. Now think about 2008. There was no universal video. YouTube wasn't able to actually transcode video, so you had to have an expensive transcoding system. Nobody knew the cost of it. Nobody had a phone with the cost of it. All the phones that I just talked about automatically have a beautiful screen in there with some type of minor data plan. So things are going to change and make it more universal. Now, the one piece that I think people often forget about in this space is messaging. If there is not a powerful message to get people to move, it's not going to matter. So all the text messaging in the world, if I'm just annoying your phone with some type of spam or broadcast that you wanted of a press release, that's not the same as an organic bottom-up text messaging program of people demanding change. The NAACP, full disclosure, we do the NAACP's program. Troy Davis, wrongful execution, was the largest growth point for the NAACP's mobile program. People wanted to know. They weren't getting the information on their televisions as to what was going on. College campuses all over the country texted in, and then in response, the NAACP had to turn out real information in real time because it was being demanded at such a great amount. So I think it really has to do with messaging, political campaigns. Scott Brown's campaign saw a good use for mobile technology. I'm on the other side of the aisle. But what they did around going, hey, you know what? Every time she goes on a radio station, we're going to send a message asking these same five questions over and over again. That was organic. Their base wanted to hear answers to those questions. Troy Davis, the NAACP's base, wanted to actually know what was going on with that case and what they could do to change the outcome.
So it's not just about the technology. The content matters a lot. Stephanie has another question from our webcast audience.
Yes, we have a question from Adam Schifris in Washington, D.C., and he has a two-part question involving campaigns and text messages on, in their Get Out the Vote effort. He wants to know if campaigns will allow people to check in at polling places, which would then remove them from the list, and also how text messaging to individual voters with follow-up to specific people they've previously engaged with via phone banking or via other sort of social networks will also help the Get Out the Vote initiative.
Okay, great question. Panelists?
I love the check-in idea. I think I responded to you on Twitter, too. I'm not sure where you are in the room. But I love the idea. And I think, too, as you see more and more social networks open up APIs for that check-in, it will allow the ability to have that action be taken on a social network or an application that they might build, and then have it being able to go into the voter bank. I have no idea if anybody's working on that, but I absolutely love the idea. And then if I'm following the second part right, I think every opportunity where you have somebody coming into your campaign, whether it's email, there to phone bank, something, getting them to sign up for your text messaging list is very key. Because if there is one day where it's probably, and Scott can correct me if I'm wrong, where this is like probably the most important thing is election day. And being able to text message those folks and asking them to vote are one of the most important.
Yeah, Aaron's already done the research on this, so I'll let Aaron talk about that. But this is the one place where I actually disagree. Okay. I think that check-ins on election day is too late. If I want to have that person organized, I want that person to check into every campaign office. I think Foursquare did a nice little sort of PR stunt around check-ins on election day last year. I don't think we actually moved any new voters in this. I think it was a nice little novelty to say Foursquare wanted to be in the game, that Facebook was already sort of dominating, Twitter was already in the game in a different way in politics. And that if we're going to use geolocation services the right way, we should actually use them to actually get more people out to vote instead of sort of patting ourselves